Hi friends, welcome to the channel Dinesh. Here we are discussing about basics of mechanical ventilator for nurses. If you are not subscribed to our channel, please subscribe. First one, mechanical ventilator. What is mechanical ventilator? A mechanical ventilator is a positive or negative pressure breathing device that can maintain ventilation and oxygen delivery for a prolonged period. A mechanical ventilator is a positive or negative pressure breathing device that can maintain ventilation and oxygen delivery for a prolonged period. So it is a machine that is used to deliver and maintain ventilation and oxygen for a prolonged period. Next, classification of ventilator. Mechanical ventilators are two types. First one is negative and second one is positive pressure ventilators. Negative pressure ventilators are the first ventilator discovered. Negative pressure ventilators are the first ventilator discovered, but nowadays it is not used. Now positive pressure ventilators are using commonly. So ventilators are two types. They are negative and positive pressure ventilators. Negative pressure ventilators are the first ventilator discovered, but now it is not using. Now, positive pressure ventilators are using commonly. Before starting mechanical ventilator, we need to know some important normal values of normal values. First one is PaO2, that is partial pressure of oxygen. The normal value is 80 to 100 millimeter of mercury. Next one is PaCO2, that is partial pressure of carbon dioxide. Normal value is 35 to 45 millimeter of mercury. Next one is pH, that is normal value is 7.35 to 7.45. PaO2, PaO2, PaCO2, pH are the values we are getting from arterial blood gas. Next is SpO2. Oxygen saturation, normal value is 95 to 100%. SpO2, normal value is 95 to 100%. Another one is SaO2, arterial oxygen saturation, that is also same range, 95 to 100%. And last one is ETCO2. ETCO2, that is normal value is 35 to 45 millimeter of mercury. These are the important values needed before knowing mechanical ventilators. So we will discuss importance of these normal values in further topics. First one is negative pressure ventilators. First type of negative pressure ventilator is iron lung or drinker respiratory tank. Iron lung or drinker respiratory tank. It is used widely during the polio epidemics. Earlier, polio also came like corona. In that time, iron lung or drinker respiratory tank are used because polio will cause respiratory muscle paralysis. So that time, negative pressure ventilators are used. That is a huge machine. Patient need to kept inside that machine, then it will make ventilation by creating negative pressure inside the thoracic cavity. That is about iron lung or drink respiratory tank. Next type of negative pressure ventilator is body wrap or pneumo wrap and chest cuirass or tortoise shell. Here is an example of body wrap negative pressure ventilator. This is also portable. So patient can shift to home with this type of negative pressure ventilator. It is a portable device with rigid shell. Next one, we will detail. We will check about positive pressure ventilator in detail. Positive pressure ventilator based on use of invasive artificial airway to deliver ventilation. Positive pressure ventilators based on use of invasive artificial airway to deliver ventilation. Invasive artificial airway means endotracheal tube. Positive pressure ventilators are two types, that is non-invasive ventilation and invasive ventilation. Positive pressure ventilators may usually use in invasive artificial airway, but in some types it is not using. That type is known as non-invasive ventilation. Another type is invasive ventilation. Non-invasive ventilation means these are mainly used in home-based setup to assist breathing. Non-invasive ventilation is used to assist breathing at home. Examples include CPAP and BiPAP machine. CPAP means continuous positive airway pressure, and BiPAP means bilevel positive airway pressure machines. So non-invasive ventilation, non-invasive ventilators are used in home-based care. Examples, CPAP and BiPAP machine. Next is invasive positive ventilation. Invasive positive ventilations are again classified into three types. They are pressure cycled ventilators, volume cycled ventilators, and third one is time cycled ventilators. Time cycled ventilators are used for only infants. So it is not discussing here. We are mainly discussing about pressure cycled and volume cycled ventilators. Next, indication for positive pressure ventilators. So what is the indication for positive pressure mechanical ventilators? First one is based on following ABG report and clinical presentation. If patient shows in PaO2 less than 50 mm of mercury with FiO2 more than 60%. That means patient is getting more oxygen, that is FiO2, but patient is not maintaining partial pressure of oxygen below 50 only. In that condition, we can use positive pressure ventilators. Next one is partial pressure of oxygen less than 50 millimeter of mercury with pH 7.25. 7.25 means that is acidosis. So acidosis with PaO2, that is hypoxia, less than 50 millimeter of mercury. Now, normal value of PaO2 is 80 to 100 millimeter of mercury. Here it is reduced to less than 50 millimeter of mercury. In this condition also, mechanical ventilator recommended. Otherwise, respiratory rate more than 35 per minute with any other respiratory symptom. Respiratory rate more than 35 per minute with any of respiratory symptom. In this condition, we can use positive pressure ventilator. Next condition, to reduce work of breathing. In some condition, we need to reduce the work of breathing. So, in that condition, we will use positive pressure ventilation. The first condition is airway obstruction. Second condition is reduced respiratory compliance. Respiratory compliance means elasticity of the lungs to expand. Elasticity of lungs to expand will reduce due to pathological condition like ARDS. In this condition also, that is reduced respiratory compliance, if it is there, we can recommend positive pressure ventilation. Next is high carbon dioxide production. High carbon dioxide production will lead to respiratory acidosis. So in this condition also, to reduce carbon dioxide retention, we can use positive pressure ventilation. So to decrease work of breathing, that is caused by airway obstruction, reduced respiratory compliance, high CO2 production. In this condition also, there is increased respiratory rate. So to reduce increased workload, we will use positive pressure ventilation. Next cause reverse life threatening hypoxia. To reverse life threatening hypoxia, that is indicated by ventilation perfusion mismatch. There is a mismatch in ventilation and perfusion ratio. Normally the value is 1. So ventilation perfusion ratio, normally it is 1. If any change is there, that will lead to hypoxia. Next cause is shunt. Shunt also will cause hypoxia. Shunt means any abnormal connection between respiratory tract. So in this condition also, a patient will not get adequate oxygen supply, that will lead to hypoxia. Next is gas exchange limitation. Any problems with lungs will lead to gas exchange limitation. In this condition also, we can use it will lead to hypoxia, then it is an indication for use of positive pressure ventilation. Fourth point is to support acute respiratory failure. If patients develops acute respiratory failure, we can use positive pressure ventilation. The causes are respiratory center failure, respiratory center located in medulla. If any lesions or any other complaints leads to respiratory center failure, in that condition we can use positive pressure ventilation. Then mechanical disruption. Mechanical disruption means any injury to lungs that will leads to respiratory failure. In that condition also positive pressure ventilation we can use. Neuromuscular disorders like myasthenia gravis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, in that condition also it will leads to respiratory failure. In that condition we can use positive pressure ventilation. Then reduced alveolar ventilation. Alveolar ventilation also leads to acute respiratory failure. It is an indication for use of positive pressure ventilation. Then pulmonary vascular disruption. Any condition causing pulmonary vascular disruption, that is blood flow to the lungs, it is reduced due to any condition. In that condition also we can use positive pressure ventilation. So these are the indication for use of positive pressure ventilation. Apart from that, some condition also leads to respiratory failure, such as thoracic and abdominal surgery, drug overdose in the sense drugs like morphine overdose, it will cause respiratory failure, and cannabis use and that and all will leads to respiratory failure. Inhalation injury means carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide or any other toxic gases inhalation, that also will leads to respiratory failure. In COPD, that is worsened case of COPD, will leads to respiratory failure. Multiple trauma, mainly chest trauma, shock, multi organ failure, these are leads to respiratory failure. In this condition also positive pressure ventilation are indicated. So conditions leads to respiratory failure such as thoracic and abdominal surgery, drug overdose, inhalation injury, COPD, multiple trauma, shock, multi organ failure, this also an indication for positive pressure ventilation. Next, physiological effect of positive pressure ventilation. Prolonged use of positive pressure ventilator will lead to decreased cardiac output, because it is creating a positive pressure in the thoracic cavity, then that will lead to decreased cardiac output. Second point, increased incidence of barotraumas. If we are giving additional more positive pressure, it will lead to barotraumas. So positive pressure ventilations are adjusted with the patient's condition and lung compliance. Then decreased urine output. Decreased urine output is due to decreased cardiac output. So that is the effect of decreased cardiac output. So adequate intravenous fluid therapy to generate normal stroke volume is essential. So patients getting positive pressure ventilator needed adequate intravenous fluid therapy to maintain adequate stroke volume. Otherwise, it will lead to decreased urine output. Next point is basic modes of positive pressure ventilators. Basic modes of positive pressure ventilators, that is controlled mechanical ventilation or CMV. In CMA, CMV, it may be a pressure controlled or volume controlled ventilation. So controlled mechanical ventilation means it is either pressure controlled or volume controlled. In pressure controlled ventilation, a preset insulatory pressure used to deliver required tidal volume. So, controlled mechanical ventilations are mainly two types. They are pressure controlled or volume controlled ventilation. In pressure controlled ventilation, we are controlling inspiratory pressure to deliver required tidal volume. First, the doctor will calculate the required tidal volume, that is according to patient's body weight, 6 to 8 milliliter per body weight. Then, according to that tidal volume, the doctor will set inspiratory pressure, that is pressure controlled ventilation. Pressure controlled ventilation, the pressure is ranges between 5 to 30 millimeter of water to get target tidal volume. Target tidal volume will be calculated by 6 to 8 milliliter per body weight, kg of body weight. For an example, if a patient with 70 kg required tidal volume of 420 to 560 milliliter. So 70 kg means 70. If patient is having 70 kg multiplied with 6, then it will give 420 ml. To if it is multiplied with 8, it will leads to 5. It will give 560 ml. So that patient's required in between 420 to 560 ml of tidal volume. According to that, we can set the pressure. How much pressure we need to set to give tidal volume of 420 to 560 ml. Like that, we need to adjust the pressure of the ventilator in pressure controlled ventilation. In volume controlled ventilation, a preset tidal volume is used. Irrespective of pressure, it will deliver a constant tidal volume in each ventilation. Here it is directly setting required tidal volume. So ventilator will deliver that constant tidal volume in each time, irrespective of the pressure exerting the respiratory tract. Patient will get a constant tidal volume. If patients needed a 420 ml, the ventilator will deliver 420 ml each time. That is the volume controlled ventilation. Pressure controlled, they are delivering, they are controlling pressure. In volume controlled, they are controlling volume, tidal volume, volume of the air. The important point in that, there is no patient triggering factor required to start a ventilation. In controlled mandatory ventilation, that is either pressure controlled or volume controlled, there is no triggering factor required for giving ventilation. The mechanical ventilator continuously will give the required amount of oxygen to the patients, irrespective of patient's ability to breathe. Next type is assist control mechanical ventilation. Assist control or triggered mechanical ventilation. Here, this point we need to remember. Triggered means this kind of mode required a triggering effort from patient. Then only this kind of ventilator will deliver the oxygen. The ventilator will respond to patient triggering of breath with either a preset tidal volume or a preset level of pressure support level. In this condition, in this mode of ventilator, patients need to trigger a breath. That means patients initiate to start a breath, then only this in this mode ventilator will deliver ventilation. This triggering, they will set either tidal volume or air pressure. So triggering, they will set either tidal volume. Patients need to, while taking breath, patients need to take that set triggering points. Means minimum 30 ml patient need to take effort, then only ventilator will deliver ventilation. If setting a pressure support as a triggering, they will support a negative or positive pressure support in the ventilator. Patients need to, while taking the breath, patient needs to initiate that much pressure support, then only patient will initiate ventilator will initiate ventilation. So triggering either a preset tidal volume or a preset level of pressure support. In addition, a preset backup rate of breath will occur if the patient does not trigger at the required rate. So it is safe to use when compared to controlled mandatory ventilation. In addition to triggering settings, there is a backup respiratory rate. If patient is not initiating that much respiratory rate, the ventilator will recognize that and will deliver that adequate respiratory rate. So it is safer than using controlled mandatory ventilation. The ventilator will recognize if patient is not taking adequate breath, then the backup ventilator rate will give by ventilator. That is the benefit of using assist control mechanical ventilation. Next point is, the pressure trigger may set from negative 1 to negative 10 cm of water. The patient should generate a minimum amount of negative pressure to start a ventilator breath. If we are setting the pressure trigger, that trigger ranges from minus 2 to minus 10. Minus 10 will use for acutely ill patients. If patients are improving, the triggering settings will increase 1 by 1. So patients need to generate some effort, then only the ventilator will sense patient is initiating breath, so it will support the breath, that breath, by giving an adequate ventilation. This is pressure triggering ventilator setting, that is from minus 1 to minus 10. In volume trigger, it may set from 1 to 7 liter per minute. 1 liter will set for acutely ill patients. When patients improves, it will increase according to the patient's condition. Then patient need to generate that much of volume, then only ventilator will deliver breath. The patient should generate a minimum amount of tidal volume to initiate ventilator breath. Either it will be pressure trigger or volume trigger. That we need to set in assist control ventilator. Next mode is pressure support ventilation or PS mode. In pressure support ventilation, preset level of inspiratory pressure support is delivered when patient triggers a breath. Pressure support ventilator mode, in a preset level of inspiratory pressure support is delivered when patient triggers a breath. When this is a type of pressure triggered ventilatory mode, in that patient need to start ventilator start breathing with a minimum effort, then only patients will ventilator will deliver adequate breath or support the breath of patient. The tidal volume of each breath depends upon the lung compliance and respiratory rate, and can be adjusted with the level of pressure support to maintain normal range. So here we are controlling with the pressure support will make adequate tidal volume. The tidal volume depends upon the patient's lung compliance and respiratory rate. Next mode is synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation. Synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation. It is like assist control ventilation. In this, the ventilator will deliver a preset frequency of breath, but allows spontaneous breath to be taken in between. So in this mode, the ventilator will allow the patient to take breath in between the preset rate of respiratory rate set in that ventilator. The ventilator breaths are synchronized with this spontaneous breath. The patient is taking breath, the ventilator will not give. It will allow the patient to complete the breath. Then if next time patient is not initiating breath, ventilator will give next breath. Like that, it is synchronized with the spontaneous breath of patient. Next is how to choose a ventilator mode. So we studied 3-4 ventilator mode. So we need to know how to choose the ventilator mode. First one is how to choose controlled mechanical ventilation or CMV mode. If you need to choose a CMV mode, the main thing is it is giving full ventilator support. In which patients required full ventilator support, that is when patient is apneic. When patient is apneic, patients required full ventilator support from ventilator. So in this condition, controlled mechanical ventilation mode we can use. When patients need full ventilator support, we can use controlled mechanical ventilation, that is apneic condition. Next is synchronized mechanical ventilation. It is used when the patient is able to initiate some breath but still requires ventilator assistance at a constant level to maintain carbon dioxide removal and oxygenation. SIMV mode we can use. Patient is able to breathe but it is not adequate to maintain carbon dioxide removal and oxygenation. In that condition, we can use SIMV mode. So it is a initial VNE mode. If patients initially apneic patients, by the use of controlled mechanical ventilation, patient's condition is improving. In that condition, as a second mode, second stage, we can use synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation as a weaning mode. Next is pressure support ventilation or PSV mode. It is used to support the patient's own respiratory effort, allowing increased patient comfort, reduced requirement for sedation, ongoing use of respiratory muscle, the opportunity to gradually reduce the level of support to facilitate weaning. Pressure support is a comfortable mechanical ventilator mode. It is used when patients need. It is used to support the patient's own respiratory effort, allowing increased patient's comfort, reduced requirement of sedation, ongoing use of respiratory muscle, the opportunity to gradually reduce the level of support to facilitate weaning. Pressure support ventilation also, it is a weaning mode. We can use. It is for patients improving from the initial condition. Next, we can check main ventilator settings. First one is respiratory rate. We need to set the respiratory rate in the ventilator, then only it will deliver that breath according to that rate. Usually, the respiratory rate will set between 10 to 15 breaths per minute, but may be altered to manipulate the minute volume, PO2 and PCO2. Initially, the doctor will set respiratory rate between 10 to 15 breaths per minute. According to patient's condition, it will change. Next thing is tidal volume. Tidal volume, it is set to 6 to 8 ml per kilogram of body weight. Tidal volume, we need to set 6 to 8 ml per kilogram of body weight. Altered if there is difficulty in optimizing PO2 and PCO2. After setting the tidal volume according to formula, if it is not delivering adequate PO2 or PCO2, then it will change according to the patient's condition. Then minute volume. Target minute volume, it is 2.5 to 12 liter per minute. It is the product of tidal volume and respiratory rate. Minute volume, we cannot set actually, we can set the alarm level of minute volume. That will ranges from 2.5 to 12 liter per minute. If it is not getting adequate minute volume, means there is a problem in tidal volume or respiratory rate. Then the doctor will check the reason for not delivering adequate minute volume. So tidal volume is 500, respiratory rate is 10, means 500 multiplied by 10, that is 5 liter. 5 liter is the minute volume of the patient. According to that, we need to calculate the minute volume. Next is pressure support. Pressure support ranges from 5 to 35 centimeter of water. It is adjusted according to the target tidal volume required. Pressure support is we are setting in the assistive control or pressure support ventilation mode. In the we need to set the pressure support ranges from 5 to 35 according to the target tidal volume. If we need to 500 target tidal volume, we need to set pressure support from 5 to 35, which level it is giving 500 ml of tidal level. That is the required pressure support. Next is inspiratory and expiratory ratio. The normal ratio is 1 to 1 is to 2, but it may vary from 2 is to 1 to 1 is to 4 in order to increase the time of inspiration in severe airflow limitation. Normal inspiratory expiratory ratio is 1 is to 2. That is, if your patient is inspiring with the duration of 1 second, the expiratory time is 2 seconds. Next is trigger or sensitivity. Trigger mainly we already discussed, it is volume based trigger or pressure based trigger. The trigger ranging from 1 to 7 liter per minute, or pressure based trigger ranging from minus 1 to minus 10 centimeter of water. Initially, a minimum trigger needed to set to initiate ventilator assisted breath. Initially, we will set the minimum trigger only. According to patient condition improving, we will increase the trigger. Next is positive end respiratory pressure or PEEP. Usually it's set between 5 to 10 cm of water. The aim of PEEP is to reduce the alveolar air exchange. The aim of PEEP is to reduce the alveolar collapse during exhalation and to increase the area of gas exchange with the minimum FiO2. So that is the main objective of the PEEP, to reduce alveolar collapse during each exhalation and to increase the area of gas exchange with the minimum FiO2. So here is an example of pressure support mode. Here the FiO2 is 50%, PEEP is set as 7, inspiratory pressure support is 20. And here inspiratory tidal volume is 288, inspiratory and expiratory tidal volume is same, and minute volume is 3.5 liter, respiratory rate is 10. FiO2 50, PEEP 7, and inspiratory pressure support is 20. Next is how to connect mechanical ventilator to a patient. Following things to be ready before connecting mechanical ventilator to patients: power supply or battery backup, ventilator oxygen and air supply, mechanical ventilator, humidifier. This is a humidifier, ventilator circuit. Next is catheter mount. This is a catheter mount. Patient with endotracheal tube or tracheostomy tube, ambu bag for giving manual breath if needed. Before connecting the ventilator, a self test run to be performed to assure the working status of the ventilator. So that is an important thing. A self test run to be performed to assure the working status of the ventilator before connecting to the patient. Also select the required mode and settings of for the patient's condition. Second thing is we need to make the needed settings before connecting to the patient. Then first make sure uninterrupted power, oxygen and air supply to the ventilator. Third point is make sure uninterrupted power supply, oxygen supply and air supply to the ventilator. Next, connect the ventilator circuit with the ventilator. Humidifier to be attached with the inspected limb or tube. Catheter mount to be connected to Y connector of the ventilator circuit. Then it connected to ET tube or tracheostomy tube. Here is the example of ventilator connection series. That is air and oxygen supply to the ventilator, power supply from ventilator to expiratory tube. Inspiratory tube is connected to humidifier. Then it is going to connect the Y connector, expiratory and inspiratory joints at Y connector. Then it is connected to catheter mount to ET tube or tracheostomy tube. Then troubleshooting or alarms in the ventilator. High airway pressure alarms. It is manifestation of high airway pressure alarm. The causes of high airway pressure alarm: ET tube obstruction. ET tube obstruction may be due to pneumothorax, severe bronchospasm, buildup of secretion, patient's coughing. Increased peak airway pressure resulting from increased tidal volume or inspiratory time is too short. Displacement of tube, either upward or downward. So what are the things we need to do if ventilator is showing high airway pressure alarm? Nursing intervention for high airway pressure alarm: is severely compromised, remove from ventilator and manually ventilate. Perform suction to clear secretion. If the cause is complete obstruction of ET, then re-intubate. Then auscultation of the lungs for wheezing, reduction in air entry and altered breath sound. If there is a pneumothorax, immediate insertion of chest drain or ICD, it will cause cardiovascular compromise. Then check blood glass to assess the ventilation status. If necessary, administer sedatives as per order. Review ventilator settings. Next is low airway pressure. Low airway pressure manifested by sounds of leakage, decreased minute volume, low airway pressure. Causes: disconnection, major leak from ventilator, burst cuff from ET tube, leak from circuit, bronchopleural fistula with massive air leak from chest drain. Nursing intervention for low minute volume, low airway pressure: check the patient attachment to the ventilator, check tubing's connection for leakage, check the cuff pressure, check inspiratory tidal volume to assess ventilator delivering adequate volume, check levels set for alarm. If still persists, manually ventilate. Low minute volume alarm: it is manifested by low minute volume alarm, audible cuff leak, desaturation alarm. Causes of low minute volume: disconnection from ventilator, ventilator tube leakage, bronchopleural fistula and chest drain in situ. Here is the example of expiratory minute volume low. Nursing intervention for expiratory low minute volume: unless the cause of cause of low minute volume is immediately traced out, manually ventilate the patient. So that is important, manually ventilate the patient if we cannot find out the cause of respiratory low minute volume alarm. Check the ventilator tubings for leakage, review ventilator settings, check cuff leakage, auscultation in the trachea if necessary, monitor air leakage through chest drain. Then high minute volume alarm, manifested by high minute volume alarm, causes patients making respiratory effort, possible ventilator malfunction. Nursing intervention include check cause of tachypnea such as possible hypoxia or hypercapnia, review ventilator settings. So that is about basics of mechanical ventilator. So before that, always follow the doctor's respiratory therapist order. You are supposed to do according to the doctor's order only. Thank you for watching this video. Please like and share this video, and don't forget to subscribe our channel, Dinas. Thank you.